From the campus of James Madison University in Harrisonburg, Virginia, welcome to Championship Sunday for the 2015 Softball NCAA Regional. As in today's title round, it features the third-seeded Rams of Fordham University coming back through the loser's bracket to face the second-seeded NC State Wolfpack, the unbeaten in this four-team regional field. A very pleasant good afternoon, everyone. I'm Kurt Dudley. Of course, it'll be afternoon very shortly here as we start this morning. Joining me today in the broadcast booth once again is Kim Fucci. And we have sat here throughout the weekend and watched these two teams play and two others. The rest of this tournament field, well, it also featured the top-seeded and 15th overall national seed, the Dukes of James Madison, which was dispatched just a little while ago, a game that was resumed after a delay because of rain last night. They suspended the game, and there was two outs in the sixth inning. Madison was trailing 2-0. The Dukes went down in the sixth, came back, got a run in the seventh, and had the tying run on board, but got no further than that, and Fordham advances with the 2-1 win. NC State is in the championship round for the second consecutive year. A year ago, they were 2-0, but lost back-to-back games to the Georgia Bulldogs, and that kept them from making their first Super Regional appearance. Today, the NC State Wolfpack again in the driver's seat, needing just one victory to make its first trip to the NCAA Regionals. Fordham, they'll have to win twice to get that program's first trip to the Super Regionals. And Kim, these two teams, they battle one another on Friday. Fordham got out early in that game, but then the bats came alive for the NC State Wolfpack.
And they did indeed, Kurt. It was a really back and forth game until, as you mentioned, the NC State Wolfpack really brought the bats out. A couple of home runs. Molly Hutchinson, look at the top of that order. You have Tyler Ross, Renata Davis, Molly Hutchinson. This NC State Wolfpack lineup can be so potent, and that's what the Fordham Rams are going to have to look out for. Again, I'm sure they have already learned after losing that first game 12-5, and Rachel Gillen in the circle for the Rams hopefully adjusted her pitches and where she's going to place the ball to the Wolfpack hitters.
The Wolfpack hitters certainly smart enough to take advantage of mistakes. We saw that yesterday. The Dukes didn't have many mistakes, but it was enough in a costly 2-0 loss for James Madison. Fordham then, of course, came back and defeated the Dukes after Fordham dispatched Binghamton yesterday in the first elimination game. So Fordham 38-19, making its fifth NCAA tournament appearance in six seasons, and the NC State Wolfpack making its third consecutive NCAA tournament. 37-20 are the Wolfpack, 38-19 the Rams, and Kim now takes a look at the starting lineups. Fordham will be the visitor in this contest.
Leading off for the Rams, the sophomore center fielder, Sydney Canessa. Batting second, the sophomore second baseman, Amy Van Hoven. Batting third, the sophomore third baseman, Lindsay Mayer. Batting fourth, the senior pitcher, Rachel Gillen. Batting fifth, the senior left fielder, Kayla Lombardo. Batting sixth, the senior first baseman, Paige Ortiz. Batting seventh, the senior designated player, Michelle Dobman. Batting eighth, the senior right fielder, Cora Iniero. Batting ninth, the senior shortstop, Brianna Turgeon. And the flex player for the Rams, the sophomore catcher, Allie Vergona. In the circle is Rachel Gillen. She brings in a 2.33 ERA, a 24-8 win-loss record, appearing in 38 games for the Rams this season, throwing 207 and a third innings, giving up 173 hits, 62 walks, while striking out 245 batters on the season. And for NC State, leading off for the Wolfpack, the senior shortstop, Renata Davis. Batting second, the sophomore left fielder, Tyler Ross. Batting third, the sophomore catcher, Molly Hutchinson. Batting fourth, the freshman designated player, Meredith Burrows. Batting fifth, the senior right fielder, Morgan Tharrington. Batting sixth, the junior third baseman, Lana Van Dyken. Batting seventh, the junior first baseman, Maggie Hawkins. Batting eighth, the sophomore center fielder, Hannah Yeager. Batting ninth, the freshman second baseman, Alyssa Compton. And the workhorse in the circle, we saw her earlier yesterday, Emily Wyman, the senior, brings in a 2.41 ERA, a 30-15 win-loss record, appearing in 50 games for the Wolfpack this season. She's pitched 267 and two-thirds innings, giving up 205 hits, 117 runs, while walking 92 batters and striking out 307 batters on the season.
Bridget Orchard is the head coach there at Fordham University, and her assistant coach, Reese Miraconda, and Laura Winner for the NC State Wolfpack, Sean Reichick. He's in his third season there, and he's obviously got the Wolfpack in the right direction. Assistant coach Courtney Oliver and Katie Grimes. The Rams and the Wolfpack button heads here this afternoon. This game was originally scheduled for a 2 o'clock start, and I never really got the rationale, but I'm sure it was a good one why they moved it up to noon. But to think that this is a regional that is paired with a West Coast regional, just buying a couple of hours could mean all the difference in travel going across the country, because this winter will face the number 2 seed, the Oregon Ducks, in Eugene, Oregon, beginning Thursday. And you got to take a day to travel at the very least.
And Kurt, also think about the weather here today, because there were supposed to be scattered thunderstorms,
right,
and we had 3 rain delays yesterday. And I'm sure the site rep, the umpires, everyone here, even the grounds crew, would be grateful if they can get through 1 or 2 games today without a rain delay.
You know, when you get a tournament like this, it would be really hunky-dory if the weather just cooperates and you can move through it and you get good games and move along. But unfortunately, we have had the weather to contend with. So before this game even gets underway, I want to congratulate the staff at James Madison, the NCAA representatives here, as well as the umpiring crew and all the coaches and players for making the many adjustments that had to be made over the last 3 days here to get this tournament in. Unfortunately, the weather has really been the only blemish on this tournament thus far. It's been a good tournament all and all. So we'll see the Fordham Rams lead off here with Sydney Canessa, a sophomore, batting at .328. She has 5 home runs and 36 runs driven in against Emily Wyman. Wyman tossing the one-hitter yesterday against James Madison. She does have a no-hitter in her career, maybe more than one, in fact. And she is also over 1,000 career strikeouts, over 100 career victories, one of only 2 pitchers in the country with 100 career wins or more that are active in the sport of softball collegiately. First pitch in this championship game is outside for a ball. And again, NC State a victory, and they move on. The Fordham Rams a victory, and we play a second game, or the second and sixth of a game here today.
And scouting Emily Wyman in the circle, I think Fordham knew coming in, she is an absolute workhorse, throws a ton of innings, probably eats innings too if she gets in trouble. She will throw a drop ball versus James Madison. I think she threw about half of her pitches for balls, and James Madison batters were so fooled by that drop ball. You see it there, that one's in the dirt, but she will throw that drop ball where it comes in looking like it's down the middle, and it makes that sudden drop, and she'll throw it 4 swinging strikes.
You know, it's interesting when you have a pitch like that. In essence, what you have done is you have expanded the strike zone by doing that, because it just, you know, certainly you have that box that you're supposed to hit for the strike zone, but when it looks like that, it just grows a bit bigger. There's a called strike. Your home plate umpire in this championship game is Steve McCown. Steve Gold is down the first baseline, and John Kernett is on the third baseline. 2-2 to our leadoff batter in this championship game. Look there at McCown, who was at third base the last game, if I'm not mistaken. Popped up on the infield. Everybody looking at each other for a moment. Now the third baseman will come over and make the catch of it, and that's Van Dyken taking control.
And good job by Van Dyken out there at third base. You saw Wyman come in a little bit, and that's the last thing you want to do as a pitcher is try to call that ball off. Leave it to your infielders, and that's what she did.
Sophomore Amy Van Hoven. You have 3 sophomores and then the rest of the lineup seniors for the Fordham Rams. And a lot of experience, a lot of postseason experience for this team, and it has helped them, I'm sure, get to this point in this particular regional.
And the Fordham Rams, a team that finished 3rd in the Atlantic 10 regular season standings, but came back from the loser's bracket, as they did today, to win the A-10 championship, and they got that automatic bid from the A-10 place in the Harrisonburg Regional, now in the championship game.
Slap to the left side, misplayed by Ross, and that creates an opportunity to go into second base, sliding head first, Van Hoven. So the first threat of the ball game comes from the Rams of Fordham. Van Hoven with the base hit, and Ross just misplayed the hop.
And a rare mistake by Tyler Ross. We talked about her yesterday, so confident out there in left field. And we'll see it take a hop. She steps back a little bit, but the ball almost looked like it took a little bit of spin there.
She also looked to be a little flat-footed at where she stood there, just kind of made it a nonchalant play, and it ends up skipping past her. So it's a base hit and an error on the play, will be ruled by our official scorer here at Veterans Memorial Park. We've seen, well, when these two teams got together on Friday, 7 errors between the two. It was not one of your prettier line scores. Swing and a miss, that's Strike two on Mayer. Mayer with two-run homers yesterday. One against the Bearcats of Binghamton as they had the eight-run rule and the victory over the Bearcats from the America East. And this Atlantic 10 champion then got the two-run homer from Mayer that proved to be the difference in the suspended game. There's the first strikeout this afternoon, and certainly will not be the last for Emily Wyman.
And don't expect Emily Wyman, just because there's a runner in scoring position, don't expect her to get frazzled, because she's been here before. She's a senior, and like we talked about before, NC State making their third straight regional appearance. So she has been in this position and in this championship game. The Wolfpack were here last year. You mentioned they lost two to the Georgia Bulldogs, so I'm sure they want to nail down this game in just one game today for them.
That's probably their mantra, just play one today. Rachel Gillen is on the in the batter's box and in the circle today, the senior, 375, six home runs, and she'll pull it to the right side off the glove of the first baseman trying to backhand it, Hawkins, and it'll end up in right field. And with that, trotting in from second base will be Van Hoven. So the error at the moment proves costly. That run should be unearned at this juncture.
And it's those little errors. We saw a couple of them when these two teams played earlier on the first day. Those little errors that you want to try to avoid. The unearned run just comes off the glove of Maggie Hawkins, and not much a Compton could do about it at second base, and a run scores for the Rams.
It still can become an earned run, but if I were scoring, I'd have that batter, maybe that runner instead of at the plate, would maybe be at third base. That advancement of the base set up the run to score. Here's Lombardo, Kayla Lombardo, the left fielder in this game, a senior, 316 with six home runs, 40 runs driven in. She also has 10 doubles, so a good power hitter, and she hits a hard chopper to your third baseman. Van Dyken makes a difficult throw. Hawkins had to nearly do the splits to stay in contact with the bag, and out at first base goes Lombardo. But a productive start for the Rams of Fordham. Usually when the Wolfpack jump out on top, they're winners, but they're trailing early, 1-0, as an unearned run comes across for the Rams in the top of the first. One run on two hits, one error, and one left on base. We'll be back with the bottom of the first after this. We go to the bottom of the first, and we will see. Most of these pitchers have worked quite a bit this weekend. So has left-hander Rachel Gillen, who's making her, 39th appearance and her 33rd start, Kim.
That's right, Kurt. And I just talked about Wyman making her third straight regional appearance, but the Fordham Rams have made their third straight regional appearance as well, and mainly led by the senior Rachel Gillen, brings in a 2.33 ERA, 24-8 on the season. You see the stats there, 207 and a third innings pitched, appearing in, like we said, 38 games, 85 runs given up, 62 walks, and 245 strikeouts. So don't be surprised to see an out by the strikeout today. Wyman has over 300, Gillen with 245. This could be a pitching battle today.
So just looking at the one miscue already in this game, you know, that could linger throughout the course of the game as the run is indeed unearned in the first, as that extra base put the runner in scoring position. They did score and did rule the second ball that was hit, Gillen's base knock that went off the glove of the first baseman, that helped the run to score with two outs. Here's Renata Davis, the all-time home run leader in the relatively short history of NC State softball. They've only been playing since 2004. And Davis goes to the batter's box. She's the first of three big sluggers up there, batting at 388 with 13 home runs, 15 doubles, 41 RBIs. The only thing not on her resume, she's not had a triple.
She could get one here.
This can be a triple's park. It's symmetrical all the way around, only 200 feet. We say only because Kim had noticed that, Baylor that has a big
Baylor is
deep center field?
220 out to center field at Baylor.
A ball and a strike to Davis. Davis has had a good tournament. First couple of games. And she'll foul it just to the left of the bag down the third baseline. It's Gillen and Vergona, Ortiz, Van Hoven, Turgeon at short, Mayer at third, Van Hoven at second, Ortiz at first, Lombardo in left, Canessa in center, and Ionero in right field. Most of these teams, they've stayed with close to their same lineup. We've seen a little bit of an adjustment, a couple of movements up and down the batting order maybe, but for the most part, other than maybe one or two position players, it's been the same for most teams here. And certainly they have found that comfort through the course of the regular season. And if it ain't broke, don't fix it, right?
Exactly. And Renata Davis, one of those players for the Wolfpack that she does have the power to hit the ball out, but also sprays the ball all over the field, will slap it between the 5-6 hole.
She also has a pretty good eye, although that off-speed pitch she can't hold back on, and there's the strikeout for Gillen. And that is number 246. And here's Tyler Ross, left-handed hitter, plays in left field, a sophomore, 317. 14 homers, 55 runs driven in. She leads the Wolfpack in both categories, hitting from the number two spot.
We saw Tyler Ross bobble a ball out in left field in the top of the inning. We'll see if she can redeem herself here.
You know, now that I think about it, most of the plays that we've seen Ross in left have simply been catching fly balls, and she seems to have a lot of comfort with doing that. And if you see her do it, you'll know what we observe. And there she just didn't feel the short hop, or it was a tall hop very well, and that ended up resulting in an extra base.
And the field could still be a little bit wet from last night, too. That could have played a part in the ball taking that weird hop.
Yeah, if you've not been with us any this weekend, this is an artificial field all the way around. Even the dirt is not real. And a called strike. It is a synthetic product. If we do get some rain, it will not absorb the rain, so it doesn't create mud puddles. It will create puddles, but not muddy ones. That makes sense. You just go up there and sop it up off the ground. Foul back, two balls and two strikes, and the grounds crew has had to do that several times here this weekend. And we do want to give kudos to that crew for their hustling. Swing and a miss for the strikeout. Two strikeouts to start off the game. While we're speaking of the weather, Kim, we actually had a little post Saturday entertainment here last night.
I was just going to mention that.
Where the grounds crew decided to go Rick Dempsey on us.
I think it was more the media team, or SIDs.
Yeah, it was SIDs as well as some grounds crew here. And we'll get to that in a moment. Here's Molly Hutchison. Hutchison, a sophomore, 283 with 13 homers, 42 runs driven in. Strike one to her from the arm of Gillen. With the tarp, there was a lot of water on the tarp, and they decided to do some tarp diving here last night. We had an announcer, somebody scoring. We did have a few line faults on some diving onto to the tarp.
It worked basically like a slip and slide.
It did.
I think Mike Pryor won the contest. Every time Pryor went up there, he slid so far. I don't know what was really propelling him forward, but he seemed to be the winner last night.
He was very aerodynamic. I think he was used to maybe body surfing since he's from the Hampton Roads area. So he kind of translated that into tarp surfing here at Veterans Memorial last night. A ball and two strikes, two outs in the bottom of the first. Just outside for a ball. Vergona trying to square it up. It's interesting, some catchers are taught to really try to square. They get that outside pitch and they fold the glove in to try to get the call. And there they get the swing on it. Striking out the side to start this ball game off is Gillen. That's got to give a boost to the third-seeded Rams against the Wolfpack in their third meeting this season. The Wolfpack beat them back in the regular year 5-0, and then here Friday 12-5. And the Rams with the 1-0 lead will go to the plate here in the top of the second.
And credit to Rachel Gillen. The top three batters in this Wolfpack lineup are the toughest to face, and she strikes all three of them out. She must have got some good rest yesterday after the rain delay.
Indeed, she probably did, as it's no runs, no hits, no errors, and nobody left on base for the Wolfpack in the bottom of the first. Well, a few of the purple and gold fans still hanging around. Some actually from the staff, but others. This is a pretty good softball area here in the central Shenandoah Valley of Virginia. And certainly the crowd much more muted with the host team not playing today. But there will be a few from the local area. And because it's a noon game, we may see people try to come in maybe even a little later because of church and all. So we'll see if that affects maybe some late arrivers here today. But again, I think with the weather, the need to travel to the West Coast, a number of factors, they decided, well, let's push this game a little earlier.
And I think that's going to prove to be effective if these two teams do play two games today. If they start at 2 o'clock, it could potentially be here until, say, start at 2 o'clock. That's two games, potentially 7 o'clock.
Sure.
And then, you know, for Fordham, they got that seven-hour drive back up to the Bronx in New York. And then NC State probably about, would say, 6 hours?
Well, they're probably, you can get there probably in close to five.
Okay,
yeah.
So, but still.
Depending on which way they go and how the traffic is. You know, get down there to the Research Triangle with NC State, North Carolina, and Duke. They're all in that Raleigh-Durham area. Swing and a miss for the strike to Ortiz. You can get there, sometimes you can make it in four, depending, you know.
Well, when I drove to Chapel Hill to watch JMU women's basketball in the tournament, they played Ohio State in the Chapel Hill Regional. That took about 4.5 hours.
Yep. Ortiz with a lift to right field, and it's going to be safe in right field, and Ortiz will take second, is sliding in under with Tharrington, who is making her second start in the tournament. And the leadoff runner is aboard for the Rams.
A tough play to make for Tharrington. Looks like she had a read on it, and the ball was going to go soundly into her glove. But it looks like she maybe even could have caught that without diving. I think she dove too soon, and the ball hit her in the wrist.
Kind of jostled it out there, so we will see a runner head over to second base now. And that is Kaylin Winokur, a junior, running at second base. Pitch is low to Daubman, the designated player, the winning pitcher in the second elimination game of this tournament. And an error is going to go against Tharrington in right field that allows Ortiz to reach base. That's fouled off towards the first base dugout, home of the visitors in this tournament. A ball and a strike.
There's some JMU fans sticking around. They just showed them on our monitor.
Yeah, I've seen a few in purple here. The 1-1 pop back out of play over the Fordham side again. The ball and two strikes. And the NC State fans getting into it. Looking for the strikeout. The 1-2 is swung on and fouled off far down the left field line. And if you're in the line at the concession stand for one of those Aramark hot dogs or maybe some chicken fingers, which are actually pretty good.
I'd say watch out there.
Yes, you better heads up in that foul ball territory. Chopper right back. Wyman will toss to first. She throws darts to first base.
Yeah, basically.
And one away in the second. Right fielder, Cora Iannaro, a senior, 283, three home runs, 19 runs driven in. Swings and misses, a little slow on that toss. Now, Iannaro today, noticed that we chatted yesterday, I brought it up about she has the longest ponytail in the tournament. Today she has it braided. Yesterday it was kind of free-flowing. Somebody needs to do a story or maybe a thesis or something on student athletes or athletes in general and the length of their hair and how it affects their game or how it helps them to defend their game. I mean, can you imagine some of the braids that are whipped around on the basketball court? They could hurt,
yeah,
you know?
Well, a lot of, I see it too with the James Madison team, a lot of, and just girls in general, girls are very protective of their hair. Once they get it that long,
yes.
I say, why don't you get a haircut? Nope, not getting a haircut. It's like their thing, you know? When they grow their hair that long, they love it for some reason.
One ball and two strikes.
I like to keep my hair, you know, about shoulder length, not all the way down to the point where I can't take care of it.
I keep mine very short.
There you go. And then there's most men do.
Then we have Devin Dilla, our replay, who has it long on the chin and on the head.
And, you know, Kelly over here,
Kelly's long on the chin, too, and he's got a ponytail, yeah. And a swing and a miss for the strikeout. Second strikeout of the ball game for Wyman.
I can't imagine Fry Nero, especially in the summer when it gets hot. I know that's when I like to keep my hair shoulder length, especially if you need to straighten it or anything like that. When it gets hot, it really becomes bothersome.
Brianna Turgeon, the shortstop, a senior, 255, five home runs, 21 runs driven in. I saw a funny tweet while we're on the subject of somebody going into a training room that was involved in this tournament and went in to get some meds. And the trainer looked at him and said, your hair needs meds too.
Well, I can tell you who that player is, but we'll keep them nameless.
The 1-0 is in the dirt. Two balls and no strikes.
Well, you know, sometimes it gets to that level where, like, you actually need a haircut with all the split ends and everything else that goes on.
Hashtag female student athlete problems.
Well, maybe you're during the course of the season, they don't have too much free time to get a haircut.
True.
So they're like, might as well not cut it. Leave it long. Let's see how long it can grow. Let's have a competition because they are athletes. So I wonder if they get competitive with it.
Well, I know a lot of them are involved in that, the cancer campaigns throughout the year, and Locks of Love, they will get involved with that. We've had it happen here at Veterans Memorial Park. The 3-0, that's outside for a ball. So Turgeon will draw the walk.
That looked like a good pitch to me, Kurt.
So we go to the back to the top of the order. And Sydney Canessa, who popped up to third base. Canessa from Wall, New Jersey. Got a number of New Jersey players on this Fordham team, which isn't a surprise. Fordham from the Bronx.
Kurt, I really should have planned this better. Being from Westchester, New York, I should have contacted the Fordham team prior to the tournament and told them to bring me some good Italian food from the Bronx. Because I'm missing it right now when I'm down in Virginia at school. It's really hard to find good Italian food, at least compared to the Bronx. You know, that's the that's the place to be for, you know, Little Italy, for all the good Italian food.
Yeah, there is actually a restaurant in Harrisonburg called Little Italy, but that's about the best of it. One ball, one strike, and we do have some precipitation coming down.
And that's why, you know, we just talked about the moving the game up because of the chance of precipitation.
And another roller back to Wyman, who will toss out Canessa at first base. So another threat rising there for the Rams, but it is squelched. No runs on no hits. One error this inning. Another, that's the second against the Wolfpack already. And two runners left on base after an inning and a half. Fordham has a 1-0 lead over the Wolfpack of NC State here on MadiZone HD Sportsnet. Some of the NC State fans are braving the elements here as the rain is coming down pretty steady. Not heavy, but steady. And now Meredith Burrows pops up to left field. Dahlman actually is playing in left field. I think we originally had her listed
as a designated player,
yes. So Therrington will come up next after the fly out to left. Therrington charged with an error in the top half of the inning. She is a senior. Morgan batting at 244 with three home runs and 13 runs driven in. Fouled off at the plate. Ball and a strike.
And Kurt, I'm forgetting. I keep forgetting. Tomorrow's Monday.
And it is.
It is summer for most students, but I start my Maymester class tomorrow for 4 weeks. I'm taking mass communication law.
Oh, that'll be fun for 4 weeks.
Yeah, I'm a little bit intimidated so far, and I'm here trying to enjoy some softball, but the thought of mass comm law keeps getting in my head, and I'm getting scared.
So that's not so the actual clouds above aren't the only clouds over your head right
yes,
now.
Yes, exactly.
Okay. A ball and two strikes on Therrington. Therrington batting at 244, the three home runs, 13 runs driven in. Takes the pitch, two balls, two strikes.
I wonder if any of these student athletes will be, usually the coaches don't let them take Maymester classes because of, you know, the playoffs, but once you get into June, you can take a June course, any kind of summer course.
That's a shallow shot into center field. Canessa charges in, and a base hit for Therrington. That is the first base runner for the Wolfpack here in this championship game.
And not much you can do about that if you're Canessa. See it. Just dropped right. You don't that and that ball, you don't want to risk diving and having it go past you despite the right fielder backing you up. But I think Canessa smartly stayed back, played it on a hop, and kept Farrington to a single.
Lana Van Dyke, the third baseman, a junior, 266, four home runs, 25 runs driven in. She'll flare one behind third base. The shortstop coming over Turgeon to make the catch. Two away.
Both these teams pretty evenly matched if you think about it. Both can hit, both have the pitching. And with Fordham up 1-0, it'll be interesting to see how the rest of this game plays out and if we have to play a second game, how that game plays out.
Junior Maggie Hawkins up next. She has a homer in this tournament, 234, 10 home runs, 33 runs driven in. In fact, her homer made her the fourth Wolfpack player in double-figure home runs this season. Here's the 1-0. Again, Vergona just holding that pitch there for the longest time.
Not giving up on it.
It's almost like she's holding it there and she's whispering, is that a strike? Is that a strike?
How much closer do I need to be?
Yeah. Where's that pitch? 3-0. Sean Reichick there in the third base coaching box. 3-0 from the left-hander. Grounded through the hole, left side. Base hit. That's back-to-back hits. Well, two hits, I should say, in the second. Not back-to-back sandwiching the pop up to short. The Wolfpack trying to build a bit of a rally here in the second, trailing 1-0. Which brings up Hannah Yeager, the center fielder. She is about halfway done with her collegiate career. She's a sophomore, 305, three home runs, 24 runs driven in. Only 9 walks, but 53 strikeouts, so she doesn't show a lot of patience. Pops up left side, and again, Turgeon will call for it. Squeezing it for the final out of the frame. So no runs, the first couple of hits. The first couple of base runners are stranded, though, for the Wolfpack. After two full innings, Rams with the 1-0 lead over the Wolfpack here on MadiZone HD Sportsnet. One nothing for the Rams of Fordham University out of the Bronx, New York, and the Atlantic 10 back-to-back champs at the plate here in the top of the third inning. Leading off, Amy Van Hoven, 5'8 sophomore. She throws right but bats from the left side, as you'll see here, and she's from West Monroe, New York. First team All-Atlantic 10. Her 70 hits tied for the most in single-season history as she opened up this tournament. But she has since broken that mark with her performance here this weekend. Swings and misses. She's down the count 0-2.
And Van Hoven, we talked about her when Fordham finished up the game versus James Madison earlier today, that she can spray it all over the field. And you kind of see the infielders coming in when Wyman pitches it, because with a slapper, she has like this, like a little dribbler like that can potentially be an infield base hit for someone like Van Hoven.
75 hits this season. There's a youngster. braving the elements as well. It's pretty pleasant outside, just a little damp.
For a second, it looked like she was in the dugout, and I was like, there's a kid running around the dugout, but she was in the stands.
Having a good time. See a lot of kids around college softball. Flared off the opposite way. Here comes Ross, and she makes the basket catch. There's the confidence in left field that we've seen.
I think Ross redeemed herself there. I mean, not from the plate, but making that good catch, even in foul territory, after misplaying another foul ball, the other fly ball.
She got it, the heel of the glove, but stays with it. Now Lindsay Mayer. She's a 5'4 sophomore from Lincoln, Rhode Island. Struck out the first time up. Popped up. It is a fair ball.
Well, Mayer was confused, and I wonder if it hit off her foot or something.
That's actually what I intended to say, popped off her foot, but.
And no argument from Coach Orchard. Interesting. We will see it on the replay. This could be a good shot. Maybe not.
No, it looked like it hit off the point of the plate.
Well, that's a momentum changer, Kurt.
You're not kidding. Two quick outs there. As just a few pitches, we're done with the third. No runs, no hits, no errors, and nobody left on base. We go to the bottom of the third, still 1-0. Wolfpack trailing 1-0. All right, we'll see the bottom and then the flip of the order here for the NC State Wolfpack. And starting it off will be the second baseman, Alyssa Compton, a freshman, 239. No homers, 12 runs driven in. There she is stepping into the batter's box from the right side. And then back to the top of the order. You got those big three bombers due up soon here for NC State. In there for a strike.
And I would like to see Alyssa Compton be patient here. And being the number nine batter, try to get on any way you can because, like Kurt just said, you have a top three, the big bombers coming up.
Popped up on the right side, should be playable. Van Hoven, who had quite a few line drives hit her way yesterday by James Madison. And she took care of all of them. Some of them sharply, some of them little humpback liners. It's like a soft toss in her direction. So Gillen yields two hits and strikes out three. In fact, those three strikeouts were the top three in the order. And she'll have to face them for a second go-round here, and that begins here in the third with Davis, who struck out on a 2-2 pitch swinging. Swings at the first pitch she sees in this plate appearance. Down the line, giving chase Van Hoven. She runs just a little shy of getting to it for strike one. An adventuresome strike at that.
I think that ball was in no man's land. Van Hoven almost was, she slid, almost was able to make the catch, but too close to the fence. And I think a good thing because she might have flirted with injury there into that fence.
Yeah, got to be careful about that. Davis, a 5'7 senior from Tomball, Texas. Again, the all-time home run leader. Reached the milestone of 50 in the tournament last year against Georgia. And has obviously tacked on a few here this year for Coach Sean Rychick and the NC State Wolfpack. Rams got their one run in the first. It's an unearned run thus far, separating these two on the scoreboard at the moment here in the third.
And Vergona really held that one, but that was just off the plate. Didn't look like it was going to be a called strike.
Wolfpack now 14-2 all-time in this particular tournament field. That includes regular season and postseason matchups. 2-2. Again, these two teams met during the regular season and actually NC State, Binghamton, and Fordham were all at a tournament hosted by NC State in the middle of March.
The NC State Hyatt Place Invitational, where the Wolfpack got the best of both Fordham and Binghamton. But Fordham getting the best of the NC State Wolfpack right here.
Lined in the left. They got through the hole. And Davis is aboard with a one-out single. That's the third hit of the contest. NC State, about almost 34,000 students enrolled at the Raleigh campus.
Really? I did not know that. So
it's
bigger
big.
Than UNC.
Yeah, it's a big one.
And how many does Duke have?
Duke is considerably smaller, I think.
Really?
I'd have to go look at that again. But
interesting.
I think Duke is not quite that large.
I would say, as far as North Carolina, probably the top three universities.
In terms of overall size?
Just overall academics.
Well, East Carolina has a pretty good enrollment, too, I would think. Yeah, and academically, certainly.
I mean, athletics,
so.
Athletics, mm-hmm. They all play
all
in there.
All three in the ACC, of course.
Yeah, of course.
But, yeah, you do have that research triangle there in the Raleigh, Durham, Chapel Hill area. All kind of centrally located. A ball and a strike to Ross. She struck out the first time up. Ball low. A lot of small schools throughout North Carolina as well.
And there you saw Vergona try to frame that, and then I see her putting her hand low. It's like she's talking to the pitching coach saying, the pitching coach probably asking where that pitch is, and Vergona saying low, low.
2-1, foul back. Count is 2-2. We were speaking of the single season record for hits for Van Hoven of Fordham. She came in with 70. That tied her, and she has 75 at the moment. Well, we just saw a record broken for single season hits by Davis. She now has 70 for the Wolfpack as she stands on first base.
Congrats to Renata Davis, the senior. We already talked about over 50 home runs in her career.
Ross pops it up, skying it into foul territory. Again, Turgeon, she's been busy right behind third base. And
solid, too.
Yeah, absolutely.
Especially versus a player like Tyler Ross, who's so confident not only on defense but in the batter's box as well and really has the potential to hit a ball out, but pops it up there and Turgeon able to handle it smoothly.
And Hutchinson steps in. She struck out to end the first. Grounds it right to the first baseman. Ortiz will step on the bag. A one-out single for Davis, one that sets the single-season hits record for the senior from Tomball, Texas, 70 on the year. But that's all that the Wolfpack can brew up in the third. We've played through three innings. It's 1-0 Fordham over the NC State Wolfpack here on MadiZone HD Sportsnet. Here's your line score. Three innings into this first championship game, I'll call it, for the visiting Rams in this ball game. The Rams are the visiting team. They've scored one run. It's unearned. That came in the first. They've collected three hits. Error-free in the field. The Wolfpack, no runs, three hits. And they must have changed a call earlier because they had two errors up on the board at one time. And they must have gone back and made Ortiz a base hit.
Was that the one off Hawkins' glove?
Yeah. No. Well, I need to go back and look. No, that would be actually off of Therrington. That was the dive in right field.
They called that an error originally?
Originally it was called an error, yes.
Well, I think they correctly changed it back to a hit then.
Okay, here's Lombardo, now the designated player. Was originally listed when we got the lineup card as the left fielder. A ball and a strike. She grounded out the third the first time up. Maybe we'll get a, I'll get a chance to go back and confirm what we believe. Just reading it from the scoreboard, we do have the official stats that we can go to. A strike and the throw to first base to complete the putout. K23, it goes in your scorebook. And that is the third strikeout for Wyman. So we should, if I'm correct, when I go look at our line, we should have Ortiz one for one, and she is. So that's what they scored it. This time she'll pop up, and Van Dyken, wearing the baseball cap, will squeeze it. She wore that yesterday, wearing it again today. And two outs here in the fourth. All right, so almost scratched that error out. And make it a double.
I think, well, you know who else goes to those hats is the Elon Phoenix.
Oh, do they roll?
They wear the white baseball caps, a CAA member. They're in North Carolina, too.
Yes, they are.
But they're a private school, correct or no?
Believes, yeah, yeah, they are private.
They're a small institute, mm-hmm. Small
they're,
private
they're
school.
They're church affiliated, yep.
Yeah.
A school that's grown very rapidly, however.
Yeah.
It, I mean,
it looks like a beautiful campus it's, from what
yeah,
I've seen.
It's a pretty new campus all in all when you look at it. A lot of the structures as they've expanded their enrollment. So many of their facilities are only the last 10, 15, maybe 20 years for some of them. Fouled off down the third baseline. One thing about growing campuses, or you know, many of the big schools, and when I say big schools, I'm not necessarily saying big in name, because a lot of schools, their names, you know, NC State, North Carolina State, okay, so it goes, but you have schools like, you know, oftentimes James Madison is considered a small school, but the enrollment's 20,000,
yeah.
So that to me is not a small school, but folks don't know it because it's not by a state name, you know, or a regional name.
In the state of Virginia, you have many institutions that, I mean, I remember just when I was looking for colleges compared to the state schools up in New York, there's a couple state schools, but they don't really have, you don't really remember the names as much as, you know, William and Mary, what else do we have, Old Dominion.
Old Dominion, George Mason.
Schools that have been around for a while,
yeah.
You can say, and kind of have had that name and people recognizing. I can say that the college system in Virginia is very well put together as far as all the colleges, and kids who live in Virginia have a good pick of the litter.
Oh, yeah, they do. Yep. Fouled off. Yeah, it's a big industry in the state of Virginia. And a lot of times the way you look at that, it kind of depends on what those regions were like economically.
Mm-hmm.
You know, William & Mary's the second oldest school in the country, in fact.
Yeah. And for I believe William & Mary, Old Dominion, all state schools, correct?
Correct, yes.
So
actually, Old Dominion was a branch of William & Mary at one time.
Yeah. So you pay the in-state tuition, which makes it that more desirable for the Virginia students.
Exactly. And, you know, you get a good deal if you're a North Carolina resident going to a place like NC State, and that kind of helps with their 34,000 enrollment as well. An easy inning. While we talk economics and academics.
If we have any prospective college students out there, you know, they're maybe seniors in high school, rising seniors that mm-hmm. are approaching the application process, probably the most frustrating period of your lives. I mean, I have to say, just making the decision for college, finding out where you get accepted is so exciting, and then you've got to whittle it down to whichever college you think suits you best. And there's so many across the country. If you're playing sports, you have that much more of a tougher decision, too, because you probably have scholarship offers from D1 schools, D2 schools even.
Or you want to continue your sports and you want to go to a Division III school to continue playing, but when you get to that situation, you're not looking at any scholarship opportunities.
But you just want to play for fun, which
yeah.
is, you know, a lot of kids do that. You've gotten on MadiZone, you've gotten to look at a couple campuses. We've shown you slideshows.
There we go, another Duck Dynasty dude here.
I think that's the same one from yesterday.
I think so, yeah. His beard is very – I think they lost a softball in that beard yesterday at one time.
Yeah.
Kind of looks – Devin, is he related to you?
Him and Kelly and Devin will have to have a fight over who has the biggest beard, longest beard. See, men get very proud, like how women get proud of their ponytails, men get proud of how long their beards can grow.
Honestly, folks, I have no idea how this turned into a hair show. I really don't. We got a good softball game going on here, too. 1-0 in the bottom of the fourth. And it's Burroughs, Therrington, and Van Dyken. 4, 5, and 6. Burroughs flying out to left. She had a big base hit yesterday in the winner's bracket game, as the Wolfpack scored 2 runs in the third. That's all the scoring there was, and it was Burroughs driving in the second of those 2 runs. Only one of those runs was earned. 2 balls and no strikes on Burroughs this go-round. And she's from Pikeville, North Carolina. Called strike. I will say that I'll be heading down to North Carolina in not the too distant future.
And is that part of your fishing trip?
Yes, part of my vacation. I have family that live out in the eastern portion of the state, as we kind of go back to those pirate days, quite frankly. 2 balls, 2 strikes.
Kurt, I need to plan a beach weekend for myself. We talked about I'm taking a 4-week May Master course, Mass Communication Law. But after that, my little sister is going to come down from New York, take the train down, and stay with me for a week. So maybe we'll go to Busch Gardens
there
or to Virginia Beach. Not too far. I mean, we're inland here at James Madison. But a couple hours from the beach wouldn't be a bad idea.
3-2, yeah, going down there in that William & Mary Old Dominion area.
Yeah, exactly.
Like you were just chatting. The full count pitch outside for a ball. We got a leadoff runner aboard. As Burroughs is on for the first time today.
And is it the third? Because remember yesterday, NC State did all their hitting in the third inning.
Yes.
Is that the third inning? So the fourth. So Fordham's got through the third inning. It seems as State has gotten most of their runs in the third inning, but now threatening in the fourth inning.
State's been good all year in the first and third. Those are
the
top two productive innings for NC State this year. And, you know, a good theory, I think it's pretty sound, is, you know, third inning sometimes they're starting to see a pitcher for the second time, and so they're making some adjustments there. They get a lot of intel after they've gone through the order one time.
Well, the tides might be turning here as NC State is threatening, and it's the fourth inning.
Swing and a miss for Therrington, who's from Youngsville, North Carolina, 5'7 senior. I need to get out the Google map on some of these spots.
And even though I'm from New York, I still have to get out the Google map with some of those New York towns I've never heard of.
They're not exactly small states.
Very true.
A lot of small towns. Nice bunt. Nope. Yeah, it is a nice bunt. I thought the umpire was calling it foul at first, but he said, no, it's fair. Therrington with a nice sacrifice bunt that pushes Burroughs into scoring position with the tying run. Rychek seems to be pleased with that outcome.
That is a pitch-perfect bunt right in front of the plate. Nothing more you can ask for from Therrington. Advances the runner. Now runner in scoring position for Van Dyken.
Yeah, actually, the pinch runner is Prickett. And Van Dyken at the plate. She popped up to short the first time up. Check swing right back to the pitcher. Spins the 360, throws her out at first. Two away, taking third on the play is the pinch runner.
And that's just the athletic ability of the senior pitcher, Rachel Gillen, in the circle of four Fordham. Gets off mound, calls off her third baseman, and just a little tip off the bat. Spins around, throws onto first for the out.
And Hawkins will come up next. Maggie, a junior from Easton, Maryland. That's out on the eastern shore, I believe, in the upper north part of the peninsula there. And she's at the plate. She is 1-for-1 today. And Gillen will face her for the second time. Pitch outside for a ball. Last time she sent it to left field through the hole. Trying to frame it again, Vergona.
I love the persistence of Ali Vergona.
She is very consistently persistent.
And you have to appreciate that if you're Gillen on the mound, your catcher not giving up on your pitches. Kind of gives you more confidence in the circle.
And a looper down behind third base, and we're tied as the RBI single from the bat of Hawkins will chase in the pinch runner, Prickett, and we are tied in the fourth.
Maggie Hawkins comes through again for the Wolfpack. She sent one out the first day of the tournament, and then moved up to the five spot in the lineup, dropped back down to seven, still getting it done from that seven spot. And like I said, she doesn't blast it out here, just a nice little hit into left field, and nothing you can do about that if you're the left fielder, so as there was a runner on third, and the game's tied.
Yeager, the sophomore from Los Gatos, California, popped up to short last time up. Takes the pitch, a ball and a strike. Wolfpack entering this tournament, playing pretty well down the stretch and continuing to do so. Now, we've spoken of NC State when scoring first. They're really good when they're only 4-13 when the opponent scores first. There's a swing and a miss with a strikeout. But they also are very tough after four innings. And usually if they're tied or leading after four, they come away with a win. So we'll see how that plays out here. In the fourth, one run on one hit. There was a walk that started off that inning. And that batter representative came around to score. So we've played four here, and we're tied at 1-1. NC State and Fordham in this regional championship game in Harrisonburg. Back with more in just a moment. I'll see some activity on social media. The folks following along this regional championship game this afternoon here on MadiZone. Do want to thank the NCAA and ESPN and Turner Sports for providing clearance so that we could bring you all of these games this weekend here on MadiZone HD Sportsnet. This is the video production associated with James Madison University, of course, the host school.
I have to say, Kurt, it's been a lot of fun gaining the experience of broadcasting an NCAA regional. I'm just a student, a rising senior, and to watch all these teams play, earning the right to get here, so competitive and so good. It's really been some good softball this weekend.
Ionero grounds out on the first pitch in the top of the fifth. She's now 0-2 today. And the shortstop, Turgeon, will come up. She walked in the second, only saw four pitches. All of them were outside of the zone for Turgeon. And she starts off this plate appearance the same way.
And they were just playing shipping up to Boston here by the Dropkick Murphys. We should call it shipping out to Oregon to whoever wins this game.
good call there, Kim. That's right.
Well, we'll create our own song.
We've been known to do that here at James Madison. Ball and a strike.
I'm sure that flight out to Oregon is tiring in itself with the time change.
It is.
You talk about the time change here. We went from 2 o'clock to 12 o'clock for the start of this game six because you look at it, you're probably flying out on Tuesday for the Thursday Oregon Regional. You go back 3 hours. Your head is all messed up because of the time. You might have jet lag. Who knows? So it does give them an extra day to kind of get back into the swing of things.
So Turgeon, who started off most and played most of the season in left field, now playing shortstop here in the at the end of the regular season and here in this tournament. She goes down swinging. That is strikeout number four for Wyman. Back to the top of the order, and Canessa 0-2. Right now, Wyman getting a bit in a groove. As you go back, she walked Turgeon in the second, but has retired now nine in a row. And that's during the second time through the rotation. Maybe 10 here if that play is completed, and it is, as Davis, guns are out. The Texan does so, and it's a quick fifth. Well, you're feeling a little bit of turn here in this game. NC State scoring in the fourth. Fordham goes down in order in the fifth. 1-1 our score. We're not going to go to break this time. Let's see if Mr. Bowmaster, can you put up our email address for us? As I said, we're seeing some Twitter activity, which is a good thing from the two schools playing in this game, but we want to give folks an opportunity to send us an email here this afternoon as well. Try to give you a shout out. It's always good to hear from folks. One, since this is an internet production, it's always nice, and we can get feedback. You know, you don't get this type of relationship with ESPN3 or anything like that. So
I would like to hear from the
Carolinians?
Carolinians, as well as the New Yorkers. I'm from New York, so
you're from New York.
You never would have
guessed. You sounded like you're from North Carolina.
If you are living in the Bronx or anywhere in New York, I'd love to hear a shout out from you. And also, of course, from the NC State fans anywhere. If you're watching in California, Sweden,
yes,
China, who knows?
Who knows, yes, anywhere. Well, what we do say on MadiZone is no matter what time zone you're in, you're always in the MadiZone. That's one of the phrases that we do have. We don't use it that often, but when we do, everybody kind of reacts like you do. Oh, yeah, okay.
That's clever.
Yep. Actually, I picked that up one time. I was broadcasting a game, and it was a men's soccer match, and there were a lot of folks watching from Europe in that particular game.
Well,
makes a lot of sense. Very popular. And in that match, there were a lot of international players, many of them from Central and Western Europe in particular, and Scandinavian countries as well. And we were getting a lot of emails from them. So I just kind of said, well, no matter what time zone you're in the MadiZone. It's like, wow, everybody said, yeah, that works out perfectly.
Is that the shining moment of your career?
Well, I don't know the shining moment.
One shining moment.
There have been plenty of dull ones, but that was that was a good one, I guess. And we have the pinch hitter at the plate for NC State. This is Morgan Medford, a sophomore from Whitakers, North Carolina. She'll lead off batting for Compton, the second baseman in the number 9 spot. And she has the 2-1 count. Medford, only 41 at bats this year, 7 for 41, one home run, 3 RBIs.
Well, I guess Compton, who was originally in the 9 spot, hasn't hit any home runs, so I guess the thinking behind Coach Rychek is let's get that big blast and let's put Wyman back on the mound because she's been pretty solid after giving up that first run in the top of the first.
Wouldn't be a surprise there. And the swing and the miss that goes down as the strikeout. And that's number 5 for Gillen.
You know, you can never underestimate how hard it is to come off the bench after you haven't swung. I mean, you've swung a bat in the pregame, but after seeing a pitcher for the first time coming off the bench, your body's cold. It's really hard to get a read on what Gillen's throwing. I always say pinch hitting is one of the hardest things to do.
Back to the top of the order, Davis, single-season hits leader now in North Carolina State softball with 70 on her year. She picked up her 70th hit in the third. And that's outside for a ball. The 1-1 swung on and missed the high riser.
And if Gillen can get through the top three in the NC State lineup in Davis, Ross, and Hutchinson, we've talked about how powerful they can be. And especially in the bottom of the fifth, they may get if they're lucky, one more at bat. So if Gillen can keep them off balanced here, it would be in her favor.
She's got a 2-2 count on the leadoff batter. Dancing around all the Wi-Fi in here, trying to get the right connection. One ball, two strikes, so we can get to those emails. Ground ball to the left side. Turgeon's been busy this afternoon, and she comes up with the assist. We have two down in the fifth, bottom of the frame. And Tyler Ross will come up 0-2.
And that was a nice looking pitch out of the hand of Rachel Gillen. It looked like she took a little bit off of it. And I don't think Ross was expecting that. Took the first pitch looking.
Here we go. Watching from the Netherlands, supporting the
Netherlands.
Rams.
There wow, you, see? Yep. All over the place.
As we finally get the email bag open here, we'll get to a couple of others while also keeping you into the game. Outside to get against Ross, two balls and a strike.
We got quite a couple.
Oh, yeah. Watching from the game from Charlotte. Talking about North Carolina. Yep, UNCW, pretty big enrollment-wise, too. That's been, or excuse me, UNC Charlotte. That kind of slipped there, guys, as a Freudian slip. And this is Taylor writing in, talking about the school systems, the university system there in North Carolina and Charlotte. In fact, I was in Charlotte for a football game back in the fall.
Well, you know, James Madison assistant coach Jennifer Herzig was a coach at UNCG.
Okay.
Greensboro.
Greensboro,
I forgot about
that. Yep. In fact, my first trip to Charlotte was to UNC Charlotte was for a baseball series back in the early 90s. From the coast of North Carolina, 5 minutes from the beach, pulling hard for the pack. Thanks for airing the games, Greg Clemens.
We are hope you are having fun on the beach.
Yes, indeedy. Of course, you get to the eastern portion of North Carolina, and a lot of places are 5 minutes from the beach. NC State student who is tuning in the game on his iPad, very impressed with the knowledge of NC State and NC schools overall. Keep up the good work, and go Pack. And there's a walk to Ross. Well, when you've been around for a few years and doing this job, you should know a little bit about him.
You've been around more than a few years, Kurt.
Why, thank you, Kim. We celebrated another year just past the other day. Former New Yorker and Ram enjoying the broadcast from Texas. The weather sure has made it touch on the teams and all of you. That is sure. Thank you. I'm glad. This is Rick Foley. I wasn't sure about this. I've heard it pronounced different ways. K-A-T. K-A-T.
K-A-T.
K-A-T.
Interesting.
Is home of Roger Clemens. Ah, should have known that. Okay, Rick Foley. Yes,
okay.
All right, because I think I said Catty yesterday.
Interesting.
Or Katie. Here's Hutchinson at the plate, 0-2.
So, Rick, you're a former New Yorker. Why'd you leave? That's what I want to know. But then again, I could ask myself the same question. I'm down here in Virginia at school, so.
Hutchinson, 0-2. She struck out and grounded out to first. Yeah, one of the things about doing these games, too, is, you know, there are places, like, for example, there's a couple of towns here in the valley. One is Stauntown. How would you pronounce that?
I'll tell you a story because when we were trying to figure out transportation, when I finally decided to come to JMU, we're like, Staunton? What's Staunton? Yeah. No, it's Stanton.
It's Stanton, exactly. And then there's another place nearby, and it doesn't sound or look anything like this, but it's McGackiesville, and it looks like it's spelled McGahiesville. A flip to second base. They do get her in time. That was a bang-bang play at second on the ground ball by Hutchinson. To Turgeon, the shortstop. She flips to Van Hoven, and the fifth inning comes to a close. No runs, no hits, no errors, and a runner left on base. After five, it's getting crunch time here, folks. 1-1 NC State and Rams of Fordham.
And Kurt, I love this email from Laura Robinson. Thought you'd like to know that not only did our seniors miss their graduation yesterday, but our pitcher Michelle Dahlman was the valedictorian of the Gabelli School of Business with a perfect 4-0.
How about that?
All these girls sacrificed so much, and they are all winners. Hail Rams of Fordham, burn the ships, from Laura Robinson.
Well,
that's pretty good.
Good story there, absolutely.
4-0 in the School of Business. And in New York, nonetheless.
You know what? And I think Ms. Dahlman will probably get employed very quickly.
Yes.
A 4-0, a student athlete, obviously very disciplined, very...
Those New York City business people will be all over her.
That's outstanding, actually. Do like to see that. So she is definitely, by definition, a student athlete. All the best to the folks in Oklahoma. Some more terrible, terrible tornadoes out there yesterday.
Oh, yes, I heard about that.
They were chatting about it during the break last night. I heard some conversation, but I didn't realize to what degree. And then I saw this morning some property that was just tangled.
Mm-hmm.
Actually, what I saw at first I thought was a photo of the derailment up in Philadelphia, but
yeah.
It wasn't that. This was a natural disaster, not a man-made one. Amy Van Hoven is 1-for-2 in this game. She singled and scored a run in the first, pops it up, and right back into the circle. Wyman, one out in the sixth.
And I read a great story. I forget which news outlet it was from now, but I read it last night on the earthquake in Nepal, the 7.8 magnitude earthquake, the epicenter in this really small town. These towns and their houses made out of bamboo and sticks, and it was the epicenter, and the town just got crushed. And you have to feel for the people. So heartbreaking when these natural disasters occur. It almost seems like there's nowhere safe in the world where, you can be 100% safe. I think every city and every place in the world has, a little bit of downside to it.
No balls, one strike. 0-2. Excuse me, that's actually low. 1-1. One out in the sixth. 1-1 score. Swing and a miss. Now it's 1-2.
And this has turned into quite a bit of a pitcher's
battle,
Kurt.
It has, yes.
I said these two teams are pretty evenly matched. You're talking about the 2 seed and the 3 seed in the Harrisonburg Regional, both with very good pitchers in Wyman and Gillen.
Well, Wyman has retired the last 11 batters she has faced. And she hasn't done it in an overpowering way. She, of those 11, only a couple of strikeouts. A lot of them ground ball outs, which a drop pitcher, you would expect that, because they're swinging over top and they're pounding it into the turf.
Very true.
One pop up, two pop ups, a liner.
That one wasn't off speed.
That's her fifth strikeout. She did have the fly ball to left. And Gillen steps in, 1-for-2. She took a smash off the backhanded glove of Hawkins. That scored the run as runner came in from second base on the play. San Antonio, Texas, cheering on the Rams. Go number 24, says Laura Hernandez. So she's a friend of Ortiz,
yeah,
I would
Ortiz.
Anticipate. 0-2.
Never been to Texas.
I've been there and making a trip in September, in fact. Swing and a miss for the strikeout. They'll have to throw it down to first base to complete the sixth strikeout of the contest. And finish off that inning. So now 13 in a row retired by Wyman. She has silenced the Rams' bats just as she did the Dukes of James Madison yesterday. Three up, three down in the sixth. We go to the bottom of the sixth inning. Again, NC State, the home team in this contest, so this is getting towards critical time.
I pressed something on the
iPad. I see what you did. Yep, I do that all the time. What you need to do is go over here and you punch this and see that puts you back
there.
Yeah, okay.
I'm guessing you're going to Texas for JMU versus SMU?
That's correct. Going down to Dallas. Never been to Dallas. I've been to Houston, Corpus Christi.
You've been almost everywhere.
No.
No, not yet.
I've got a lot of many more places like to go.
Once you retire, if ever.
If ever, that's right. Joanne Velarde enjoying the game from Palm Desert, California again this morning. And Allie Vergona is her niece.
Tell Allie, did Allie learn her framing skills from you? Because she loves framing that ball, and it's paid off so far.
Auntie Joanne and Uncle Jim. Jim and Joanne. All right, I think we got another one that did come in here. This is better than commercial breaks, isn't it? Let's go State and Dad from the Right Chick.
Aw.
And the boys, AJ and Drew. How about that? And that's from Trish Reichick. Outstanding. I bet they're fun to watch around the ballpark. And let's see here.
Another from Los Gatos.
California. Shout out. Where it's sunny out there in California, go Hannah. That's a Michael Yeager. All right, back to the game here. We go to the bottom of the sixth. Meredith Burrows will lead off with a Wolfpack and a called strike. Burrows walked the last time up, and she scored the tying run. Actually, her pinch runner scored the tying run. That was Macaulay Prickett came across for the Wolfpack. We got a little bit of sunshine coming in, Kim.
And maybe just at the right time. You know, this is 1-1. Could go into extras here, and then if Fordham wins, you have a whole nother game to play. And we definitely do not want a rain delay. I think three was enough.
Yeah,
for yesterday.
That's plenty. That is absolutely plenty. The 0-2 to Burrows. Ooh, just does miss. Pretty close.
Gillen staring down the home plate umpire. I don't think she liked that call.
And lined, heads up down there. A ball and two strikes.
There's a shot at John Salem working the camera.
He does a little bit of everything while producing. Check swing and out at first. Burrows down 1-3. Therrington comes up next. Singled in the second inning with one out. She made it to second base, then had a sack bunt that helped to set up the tying run.
Now batting, number 22, Morgan Therrington.
We had another email. And I know I'm going to pronounce this name wrong. From Christian Sengfelder?
That's close, I would think.
Hi, guys. Great job with broadcasting the games. I really like it. Just wanted to reach out to Mrs. Robinson and the fan from the Netherlands and make sure that the international support is still going. I am rooting for the Rams out of Germany. Let's get it, Rams. Finish strong for all the seniors. From Chris. So, Germany.
Therrington pops up to first base. Two away here in the sixth.
Never been overseas yet. Would love to go to Italy someday.
I bet you would.
We talked about the good Italian food in the Bronx. I mean,
you need to talk to Kirby Burkhalter, former James Madison player of the year in the Colonial Athletic Association. She just spent a year playing professionally in Italy. She did like the food. Van Dyken at the plate. 0-2, a pop-up to short, ground out, back to the pitcher.
I'm sure she could eat all the Italian food as long as she was working it off by playing basketball.
She came back in pretty good shape. Although she did say she lost a little muscle mass because they don't require the strength and conditioning there do.
That's interesting.
And in many of the collegiate ranks, and certainly do at JMU, I'm aware of. Two balls and a strike. One run, three hits, no errors. 1-4-1, respectively for the Rams and the Wolfpack. 3-1. And caught on the fly as Turchin comes across again. She's been very busy today. Three up, three down for the Wolfpack in the sixth. We go to the seventh inning. We're tied 1-1. Wolfpack of NC State and the Rams of Fordham University all tied up here at JMU's Veterans Memorial Park in the regional championship game. Kayla Lombardo. Swing and a miss. Lombardo 0 for 2. Grounding out to third, striking out. Down in the count 0 and 2.
Getting to crunch time here, Kurt.
Yes, we
are. 1-1, top of the seventh. It's win or go home for Fordham. NC State might feel a little bit more comfortable knowing that this is not the win or go home game for them.
Flair down the right field line, giving chase and making the diving catch. Therrington doing an excellent job this time, where earlier in the game she couldn't come up with that catch. That is a big time catch in the seventh inning. Sometimes it's a matter of timing.
And I think she redeemed herself there from the earlier one that hit her on the wrist.
That she did. Here's Ortiz. Got a friend watching down there in Texas. Swing and a miss. Just a right one. Ortiz with the double that Therrington tried to get to as the ball jostled out of her glove as she was diving, trying to slide underneath for the catch. That's a called strike. Ortiz looked like she wanted to pull the trigger, just couldn't do so quickly enough. She pulls it this time. She'll need a little longer bat. Seven strikeouts for Wyman. She just continues to add, doesn't she?
She does indeed. Talked about her over 300 strikeouts this season coming in. If I ever get a chance to talk to Emily, I would like to ask her if her arm feels like it's going to fall off at any point. For 4 years has been an absolute workhorse in the circle for the Wolfpack.
Daubman. Couple of ground outs, both times on late swings. This time pops it up. And dropping into no man's land, the center fielder will come over. Yeager will get it in a hurry. She'll get it back to second base. So a two-out single for Daubman.
And Yeager smartly played that one on a hop. It looked like either Yeager or the right fielder, Ioniro, were going to both try to dive for it. But I think they smartly held up there, played on a hop, and just hold her to a single.
You know, the thing that you have to do, really a very cerebral player will understand the situation that they're in before the pitch is made. Inning, score, who's on, who the batter is, what their speed is, where you need to keep them limited. And don't give them any free bases. Ioniro, low, and that's scooped out of the dirt by Hutchison. Two balls and no strikes. I mean, you can't just wait for the ball to hit to you and then go, oh, wait, let me think about this.
Yeah.
What do I need to do?
There's really no time to think about it once that ball's in the air.
Called strike. Yep.
And that's why you have to expect the unexpected, I guess, and think about, especially if there's runners on bases, and which situation, depending on what situation happens, where I'm going to throw the ball.
Swung on and missed. As that squares the count, two balls and two strikes. Rhythmic clapping from the NC State fans, and it helps Wyman register her eighth strikeout. So that means we will go to the bottom of the seventh. We enter our first quote-unquote walk-off inning in this championship game. We're tied at one as the Fordham Rams scored an unearned run in the first inning with Van Hoven scoring after an error that allowed her to advance to second base into scoring position. Then Gillen singled off the glove of Hawkins into shallow right field. And when she did, the run came in to score. And then in the fourth inning, Burroughs walked, and then her pinch runner, Macaulay Prickett, she came around eventually to score after a sack bunt, put her in scoring position. She scored on the single by Hawkins, and she flared it just above the third baseman, dropped it right down the left field line, and Prickett came in to tie the score at 1-1. That's where we are as we go to the bottom of the seventh. The score's 1-1 there, even on your mobile phone, for that NC State fan, as Hawkins, Yeager, and Compton. Hawkins 2-for-2 with a couple of singles, both of them to the left side. The last time she was up, she pushed across with her single to left, the tying run. That gives her actually 34 RBIs now. She entered the game with 33. That ball is hit to deep center field. And there it is, the hero of this game, Maggie Hawkins, her second home run of the weekend. And that home run will send the NC State Wolfpack all the way out west to face the Oregon Ducks in the Super Regionals. One pitch in the bottom of the seventh ends this ball game. Hawkins' 11th home run of the year. And she was just swinging from the hips that time, and she drives it right out to right center field for the walk-off win for NC State, as the Wolfpack will be the team that emerges from this regional. In fact, Gillen knew it. She didn't even look at the ball as she knew it was out of there. And what a great moment for Hawkins. As Maggie Hawkins, the junior from Easton, Maryland, will get a chance to play coast-to-coast with her teammates now, as the Oregon Ducks will welcome in the Wolfpack of NC State for the Super Regionals. The Super Regionals will be the best out of three, best two out of three, and that series will begin on Thursday out in Eugene, Oregon. So congratulations, first of all, to the Rams of Fordham as they get into the championship round. And congratulations to the Wolfpack of NC State. And it looks like Kim Fucci has already hustled. She's really fast. She got down to the field. I mean, it was the pitch, and she raced right on down there. Kim, you're exceptionally fast, and she has the winning head coach of the Wolfpack of NC State down on field level. Kim?
We're here with Coach Rychek, the winning coach, NC State, onto their first Super Regional. Coach, how's it feel?
It feels awesome.
You're going to get field.
I don't really have a lot of words right now. It's been exciting. We played great all weekend and got the big hit every time we needed.
You could tell in his voice that he was expecting that one.
And we just got big hits all weekend. We didn't have a lot of chances the second two games, but we made them count. And big hits today. Emily Wyman was great after the first two innings today. And hey, we're going. That's all. We're excited. It's what we wanted this weekend, and kids did what we needed to do to get there.
Congratulations, Coach.
Thank you.
Let's see if we can get Miss Wyman. We'll see if we can track her down as well, as she certainly had one whale of a tournament. Gave up just the one unearned run in the last couple of days. Rychek getting the regional championship dousing. And we'll, in just a moment, there's a quick huddle, quite obviously. So the 2015 Harrisonburg champion from the one of the 16 regionals across the land will go to the Wolfpack of NC State, of course, out of Raleigh, North Carolina. And those folks will now be booking their flights across the country to take on the Oregon Ducks. As this weekend, we start with a field of 64. It gets whittled down to the final 16. eight sites will host Super Regionals, again starting Thursday, and the winners of those best out of three will continue on into Oklahoma City for the Women's College World Series. And they're still cheering down on the field level. And a good time for the Wolfpack of NC State. All right, pull her out there from the crowd, Kim. Let's get to the, yeah, there she goes. We're going to pull her across here for the interview. And, Kim, whenever you get situated, actually step a little. There we go. We got a new camera angle. So go right ahead, Kim.
Well, we're here with the senior Emily Wyman. Emily, an absolute workhorse in the circle over 4 years. You came into this game with over 300 strikeouts. What does this win mean to you?
It's probably one of the best of my career. I don't have words right now, but they just came through for me today, and I'm really, really proud of my team, and we've worked really hard for this moment right here.
And what can you say about Maggie Hawkins, the transfer from Hofstra, her first year here, hitting that walk-off home run?
It's very deserving, and I couldn't be more proud of her, and she really stepped up for us, and we said today someone was going to have to be the hero, and she was that for us today, and we're just so excited, and I don't even know what to say.
And so it's off to Oregon.
Yeah.
What have you heard about them?
Great ball club. We know it's going to be a tough battle, but you know we're really excited for the opportunity. That means we're two wins away from the World Series. So you know this is kind of a opportunity of a lifetime for our team, and it feels good to help carry them here, and we're really excited about it.
Congratulations, Emily.
Thank you very much.
All right, thank you, Kim. Kim, come on back up here. We'll close it up here as Kim will make her way back up here into the press box as we'll finish our coverage here this afternoon. Now, I'm going to disagree a little bit with that starting pitcher there, Emily Wyman, as she said that Maggie was a hero. And, of course, I mentioned that in the play-by-play. But, you know, she was the hero of the moment, the decisive play. But to get there, it's a journey along the way. And certainly the things that Wyman can do on the mound as she shut down the Fordham Rams. The Rams certainly hit the ball well yesterday against Binghamton to get to the losers bracket championship game last night. And then she shut down James Madison as well yesterday, a team which was among the national leaders in overall offensive numbers, RBIs, as well as batting average, the whole nine yards. And she shut the Dukes down yesterday on the one hitter. And she'll continue on. She has over 100 career victories. She picks up another one here in walk-off fashion, she does, as the North Carolina State Wolfpack will advance 2-1 with the final. It was one run on four hits and no errors for the Fordham Rams. And Maggie Hawkins, the transfer from Hofstra, she sends it over the wall there. And that is the difference in the game as the Wolfpack, two runs on five hits and one error. Wyman, seven innings pitch, four hits, one run. It was unearned. She walked one and struck out eight. Wyman improves to 31-15. Gillen takes the hard luck loss, 24-9. This ball game took an hour and 29 minutes to decide this championship. And Kim, you hardly had a chance to get on the field, and boom.
I was down in the I didn't even get to see the home run. I was down walking down the stairs.
But you heard the cheers, I'm sure, as you're walking on that side of the stadium. Just can you share with us a little bit kind of the energy that you felt there on the field when you came around the corner? I know it was a different team than you probably obviously would have liked to have celebrated with, but to kind of be down there, just that experience.
Well, it was just amazing, Kurt, and you know, to see NC State, their first super regional appearance, you gotta love it. You gotta love, you know, the excitement. After interviewing Emily Wyman, she was so excited. I think she deserves this. You know, the senior, 1,000 strikeouts in her career, just amazing. And Coach Rychek, he warned me before. He said, you might get a little wet here, so I think I smartly backed away.
Yes, you did. Yes, you did.
I guess I've seen multiple reporters get soaked, and I didn't want to get soaked today, even though it might have felt a little good. But, Rychek was so happy, and this is a great time to be a Wolfpack fan.
Yeah, you see, and indeed, this is the type of tournament. Tears come out with disappointment, and tears come out in joy. And for the NC State Wolfpack, there will be joyful tears. For the Fordham Rams, disappointing tears as well. For James Madison and Binghamton, the same. But all four of these teams certainly deserved their chance to get here this weekend, to get a chance to go to the Super Regionals. And emerging out of this pack is the Wolfpack of NC State, as they will go on to face the Oregon Ducks in the Super Regionals. And again, that regional begins out west. So a lot of the North Carolina State fans are going to have to stay up a little later, because if they play a 7 o'clock game out there, that's 10 o'clock here on the East Coast. So they have to make that adjustment, and that's not only flying across the country, but the time adjustment of the time of day that you play could impact it as well, particularly since they're playing Thursday, Friday, and maybe Saturday if they split the first two in that meeting. Before we wrap things up, let me take a moment here to thank a number of folks. First of all, the staff at James Madison University for an excellent job. You know, if it were not for the weather, this would have been an extremely smooth tournament. And even with the weather, I think the staff here did an excellent job of keeping things going as best they could. Thanks to the NCAA representatives that were here for this first-time regional in Harrisonburg, to the athletics communications staff of the host school, James Madison University, to each of the sports information directors from each of these programs, Chris Strach of Fordham University, Justin Wilson from North Carolina State. He'll head back to Raleigh, pack his bags, and head west with his team, to Dave O'Brien of Binghamton University, and to, of course, our own Chris Brooks at James Madison University, the softball SID for JMU. I want to thank the crew from Telemedia Productions for all the fine work that they did, as Kelly Bowmaster was your director for today. Justin Roth has been directing throughout the weekend as well. Devin Dillip, beard and all, has been doing a lot of the replay. And not to say that Kelly's beard wasn't involved today with the directorship as well. And thanks to the producer of it all, and that is John Salem, and to all the camera operators who had to brave the elements here this weekend too, and taking care of some very expensive equipment out there, make sure that it keeps up and running here as we get to the end of this tournament, and we may have the best weather of the tournament this afternoon, and it's nice and sunny out here right now. And thanks to my broadcast partners here this weekend. Nikki Newman was here with us on Friday, Brandy Sowers yesterday. They had other responsibilities today, couldn't be here. And to Kim, wonderful job. I hope you enjoyed the experience. It certainly can be a big time experience, for particularly for somebody of your age to have to the chance to work an event like this and to see an event like this. I know you love the sport of softball, and an excellent job covering these teams this weekend, Kim.
I really did love this, Kurt. You know, with James Madison, they're going to be back next year. Fordham, you know, I'm from New York. I feel for the New York fans. NC State, they did a great job, you know, and they put themselves in that position by winning that first game versus the Fordham Rams. And Binghamton, their first NCAA tournament appearance, it was great seeing them here. I think they were just happy to be here. They were so happy when I was in their dugout, so pumped up. You just got to love all the excitement from all the teams up here broadcasting and seeing all the emotions out in the field. These teams putting in 100% after a long season. You finally make it to the regionals, and only one team prevails. And today, and this year in the Harrisonburg Regional, that'll be the NC State Wolfpack, and they're on to Oregon to face the Ducks.
Both teams are coming out of this weekend with records of 38-20, but the NC State Wolfpack will have a chance to add to that total, as they will face the Oregon Ducks, and that kind of gives us in Harrisonburg an interest in watching what the outcome might be for that tournament. Congratulations to all four teams, and best of luck to the Wolfpack of NC State. On behalf of JMU Athletics and MadiZone HD Sportsnet, thank you for joining us. We want to thank all those that emailed us throughout the course of the weekend. Hope that you did enjoy our coverage here on MadiZone HD Sportsnet, which is presented to you here from James Madison University. And so for Kim Fucci this afternoon, I'm Kurt Dudley. Our final score, the champion of the Harrisonburg Regional, a historical one it has been, the Wolfpack of NC State beating the Fordham Rams 2-1. Good afternoon, everyone, from Veterans Memorial Park on the campus of James Madison University in Harrisonburg, Virginia.